Christopher Media. Let's make some noise.
Ich glaube schon, dass er einfach wirklich tiefer sieht in die Seele rein, wie die meisten.
He portrays accurately certain dark areas.
This is coming from someplace else, and Giger is, you know, just the guy that this other world is kind of introducing themselves to us.
Er fühlt sich im Unheimlichen zu Hause. Das, was wir alle fliehen, ist sein Zuhause.
Es ist alles anders wie der normalen Dom.
This is what I call Hans Rödi, a visionary.
Traum zurückzukehren, aber es ist am selten möglich. Die wenigsten Leute getrauen sich, ihre Träume zu erzählen oder irgendwie darzustellen.
Ich denke immer wieder, wenn ich das Bild dem Vater oder der Mutter zeige, die verschrecken ja zu Tod.
Welcome to the projection booth. I'm your host, Mike White, and joining me, of course, is Mr. Rob St. Mary.
Hello, sir.
This week, we are doing a little bit of a special episode here on Dark Star, H.R. Giger's World, a fairly new documentary. It's just been playing the circuit of festivals lately, and it is opening over here in the U.S. in a little bit here, opening up in May. Let me say that again. Opening up on May 15th in the United States, and we just wanted to talk a little bit about this nice little documentary about one of, I feel, our greatest artists who sadly passed away last year.
And to me, this is the perfect double feature to Jodorowsky's Dune, because Giger, of course, is in Jodorowsky's Dune, and he talks about working with Jodorowsky and developing some of the stuff that he was going to do for that film that was never made, and then it obviously got pushed on to other places, such as Alien and other designs going forward. And it's just it's an interesting film to watch because we get to know him a little bit more. The one thing that I was a little interested in with him, and you get to know sort of him and his wife and his mother-in-law and his assistants who help him, is I was kind of wondering if at this point in his life, if he was in a lot of pain, because he doesn't seem to smile a lot. He's kind of moving slow at times, and doesn't seem all that happy of a guy. But when they have the archive footage in there, it's a little bit of a mix. You get the idea that maybe he's a little more content in his youth. So I'm trying to figure out if he's always been a little bit depressive, or if it's just being in pain, because this was made, I think it was wrapped, 6 months, 8 months before he died.
Yeah, the director, Belinda Sallin, was still doing work with him up until, I think, 5 days before he died, as far as the doing photo shoots and that kind of stuff. So we'll hear from her in a little bit here and hear a little bit more about the last few months that he had. It was kind of sad. Like, we went to see Jodorowsky's Dune, Andrea and I, and listening to Giger talk, he had a real hard time getting the words out. And as he's kind of gasping for breath and all this, after we watched the film, Andrea said to me, you know, it seems like that guy had congestive heart failure. It doesn't sound like he's doing real well. And then I think it was just like a month or two later that I read that he had passed. And it's just like, yep, he definitely wasn't in the greatest health in those last, I guess, year or so of his life. So it's kind of a shame. And especially, I don't know if, I'm sure that if you said, okay, H.R. Giger, what has he done? Maybe you're going to get, 1 out of 10 folks, unless they're really super film savvy, that know that he was the guy who designed Alien. And then going beyond that, good luck.
There are certain things that he's done depending on what music you're into. And that's one of the things that's in here as well, is I remember when I was a kid and I wasn't a big prog rock fan, but he did the album cover for Emerson, Lake & Palmer's Brain Salad Surgery. And I remember that album cover because his style is very distinct. And that's one of the things that's interesting in this documentary, is we learn how he does what he does. And a lot of the stuff that he does is totally freehand. He doesn't sketch things out. He doesn't draw things out and then make it. They actually show him with the airbrush painting on the canvas and just doing it. And it just all comes out of his head. And he's often been labeled as a surrealist, which to me is interesting because when I think surrealism, I want to, like, to me, surrealism and absurdist ideas seem to mesh more. And to me, his stuff is far too serious to be surrealist in my mind. Although I can see it being the darker end of surrealism, because when you look at Dali's work, who people would say, okay, that would be the epitome of mainstream surrealist painting. It's very bright. It's outlandish. It's melting clocks. It's, you know, it's a tiger and a bee and all of this stuff jumping out of an orange and all of this stuff, you know, giant Christ like floating and, you know, it's like all it's brighter. Like Dali's work is much brighter than Giger's vision. I mean, Giger basically lives in the land of shadows and black.
Yeah, to see color in his work is something remarkable. I mean, you'll see some like darker or just some like hues of green or blue, but so much of his world is just black and white or black over white, and just absolutely gorgeous stuff, though, man. And just as a little bit of an aside, whenever I hear Emerson, Lake and Palmer's Brain Salad Surgery, I always get that confused with, for some reason, I get that confused with the two albums by Spinal Tap, Brain Hammer and Shark Sandwich, for some reason. So I always think that that's a fake album name for a Spinal Tap album, but it's not. It's a real thing.
Yeah, it's a real thing. The thing that's interesting in this documentary is we get the background of him and how his one girlfriend, who is an actress in that, was his muse, and he used her facial features and all of this stuff in his early work. And you can see it through, you know, that Emerson, Lake and Palmer album cover, in certain parts of the Alien stuff. And she tragically is no longer with us. So there's all of this stuff, and I don't want to ruin it because there's some amazing things in here. But the other thing that was also kind of a revelation to me, and I have a friend of mine named Mark who listens to the show, Mark Rudolph, who is a Detroit area cartoonist and illustrator. And he's done two books so far focusing on things he's really into in terms of music. One was he did a whole book that was a tribute to King Diamond and Merciful Fate. And he also did recently a book on Celtic Frost. And the fact that the lead singer of Celtic Frost became Giger's assistant and is in the film and talks about Giger and how his visuals were important to him and the music and helped to develop that. And then he became the assistant of him and learned all of this stuff and really appreciates his work and had such a profound effect on him is quite interesting and quite good too, you know, to sort of see those connections.
Yeah, there are moments in this documentary. It's funny because this isn't a standard documentary that we are used to seeing these days, where it is very much the, you know, in 1949 this happened, and in this year this happened,
and just timeline. Yeah, just here's your timeline and fill in the pieces. Yeah.
Right. Or, you know, there is an event that is going to happen, and then throughout the preparation for the event, we were going to put in these pieces of what has led up to this event. You know, it's not like this is the opening of the H.R. Giger Museum at the end of the film, and here is the whole story of H.R. Giger as we go through it. And instead, it is very much like the title of the film, H.R. Giger's World. The film is essentially about Giger's house and the people that live or visit the house, and just what a microcosm this is, and then we get a little bit of the past, mostly in relation to him or to some of the objects in the house, which I found to be a very interesting way of doing this documentary. And I was glad that it wasn't one of these typical, you know, voiceover narration kind of things. We didn't have a narrator for this. We found things out in a much more of an organic fashion, which seems very appropriate for Giger's work. So let's go ahead, take a break, and play an interview with the director of Dark Star, H.R. Giger's World, Belinda Sallin.
My name is Belinda Sallin, and I'm a filmmaker.
How did you get your start in filmmaking?
I was a political journalist. I worked for a TV magazine and Swiss television, a political TV magazine. After that, I started making documentaries also for TV stations here in Europe. And the film Dark Star about H.R. Giger is my first feature documentary.
How did you first get exposed to H.R. Giger? What was the first thing that kind of came on your radar?
Well, of course, I have known Giger's art since my youth. I saw his pictures a little bit everywhere, in shared flats or in comic shops and bookstores. And I think probably the first picture I saw from him was Brain Salad Surgery, the art cover he did for the band Emerson, Lake & Palmer. But I remember posters like Birth Machine and Lee One. And of course, I saw Alien. I think I was traumatized when I saw it the first time. So, and it changed, really changed my perception of the whole genre, of the science fiction genre, fortunately. I lost the art of H.R. Giger a little bit of my sight. But the very evening, I happened to meet Sandra Beretta. She is alive, an ex-former life companion of H.R. Giger. All these images immediately came back to my mind, so I never really forgotten them.
What is his popularity like in Switzerland?
This is a difficult question because, of course, everybody knows H.R. Giger. Everybody knows that he won an Oscar at 1980. So he's very, very popular, but he never gets the acknowledgement here in Switzerland from the establishment. He never gets the acknowledgement of the art institutions. And so he was suffering about that. So he was very, very popular, but without the acknowledgement. And it was really a pity because over the last 10 years, it began to change here over in Europe. He had a lot of large solo exhibitions a little bit all over the place. He had solo exhibitions, large exhibitions in Paris or in Germany or in Austria, but he never did that in Switzerland. He never got that in Switzerland. So I don't know, perhaps he was too provocative. He was breaking too much taboos for the reserved Swiss people. I don't know. But it was nice to talk to Hans Rudi Giger just before he died, because I think I had the impression that he was no longer interested in that discussion about his work. And I didn't hear any bitterness in his voice when he told me, "They don't show my work here in Switzerland." And I thought maybe his composure came from the fact that he knew he didn't need Zurich to enjoy worldwide success. He didn't need Switzerland to enjoy worldwide success. And I thought, who needs an exhibition in Zurich when you have already reached countless people all over the world with your art?
How did you decide to choose him as the subject of your first documentary?
Well, I think this was a coincidence. It was this evening, I told you before, when I met Sandra Beretta, his former life partner. So I was immediately interested in the subject. And of course, it was the first meeting with H.R. Giger himself that truly made my interest in making the film. And when I was entering his houses, I was completely overwhelmed by impressions. And I mean, as a journalist and a filmmaker, I had seen many different kinds of houses and flats, but I'd never in my life seen anything so unusual. So crossing the threshold was like entering another world, entering another time zone. It was like I had entered one of H.R. Giger's work of art, dark and threatening, but I didn't feel threatened. And this was, of course, because of H.R. Giger himself. He really was a really, really kind man, very charming, very humorous. So I was also very surprised. He wasn't the man I expected he is. He was not a dark character, so I was interested immediately. And the very first time I entered his houses and I met H.R. Giger, I wanted to make this film.
Yeah, tell me about that house. How big is that house?
Well, the house is very unusual, really. And it is very important for the film. It is quite a protagonist in the film now. I always thought it's like an organism. When I entered there, it was all the time, it was very warm. Hans really Giger liked when the heat was up on the maximum. It was very warm and very dark. And it's like a protagonist in the film, living like a living organism. And in fact, they are three houses over the last 40 years when H.R. Giger, every time he had a little bit of money, he bought one house more. So at the end, he had three houses, but they were together, and he made doors between the walls. So you could you didn't have to get out for to be in all three houses, and it's like a labyrinth. it's not huge, really not huge, but it's difficult to get the orientation in there.
What was it like going on that train ride?
Oh, it was cool. It was cool. I thought Hans Rudolf Giger, it was like a little boy with this train ride. And he always said, well, this is my way to work. I would say it's about 8 meters. So he had a train station in the house, and for the little house in the garden where he did his work. So he went to work with the train. So it really was very funny.
Yeah, sometimes it feels like the house and the objects that are in the house are almost speaking for him, because he doesn't say a whole lot in the documentary.
No, not at all. He don't say a lot in the documentary, and I think he was very relieved when I told him we don't do a lot of interviews. But he didn't like to talk about his work. He really didn't like to do that at all. And as you see in the film too, he is quite ill. His health is very weak. So the shooting was very special. So we couldn't do a lot of interviews. And well, yeah, as you said, the house and the people around him are speaking for him.
I love the interview that you do with the guy from Celtic Frost when he's talking about how much Hans Rudi's work and support meant to him. That is such a touching scene.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really touching. And Tom is really he's a good friend. He was a very good friend of Hans Rudi Giger, and he really is touched today when he tells about the relationship with Hans Rudi Giger. And he portrays Hans Rudi Giger very much, because H.R. Giger, he was really a kind man. He was very supportive. He was very interested in art for all the other people around him. So it's quite important, the quote from Tom in the film.
What were some of the things that you learned while making the film that you didn't know beforehand?
Well, a lot of things. I didn't know the work of Hans Rudi Giger as well as I do now. So it was very surprising for me, and I found that no matter what you think of the art of H.R. Giger, it's undeniable that he is an exceptional artist. He is unique and unmistakable, and he had a tremendous international charisma. So I found all this because I told you before, here in Switzerland, he is famous. Everybody knows him, but the acknowledgement is not here. And I think this is a pity. It's wrong.
There's a part in the film where he goes to his museum. Was that the opening of the museum?
No, this is not the opening. The museum exists now for 15 years. So it's not the opening. But this was a very, very special scene, if you want to tell me that. I never thought it was the last time that H.R. Giger visited his museum. This was the last time he was there for us. And he didn't like to come that day because he didn't feel very well. So it really took a great deal of persuasion on my part. And in the end, he was there, and he only spent a short time in the museum, and he didn't want to stage anything at all. But we managed to film him in his beloved spell room for a few minutes. So, and it was the last time he was there in his museum with us. So it's a very precious scene for me.
So you were there with him really close to the end of his life, it sounds like.
Absolutely. We did the photo shooting with him 5 days before he died.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That was such a loss.
Yes. We were shocked and we were very, very sad. Even we knew that his health is weak. We knew that. But I thought a lot about that during the shooting. It was very special, as I told you, because his health, that meant that he was only available for very short periods of time. So I really had to consider very carefully what I wanted from him and decide which scenes I definitely wanted to shoot with him. Then we discussed each scene in great detail with the crew. Normally, I don't do that for documentaries, so it was very special. But it was interesting, but because when H.R. Giger showed up, then the scenes took a very documentary, very authentic feeling, in my opinion, because we all knew there was only this one take, no retakes, no discussion or direction. So I guess H.R. Giger also a lot of credit for almost always agreeing to my wishes.
When somebody is so popular, like with something like Aliens, kind of jettisoned him to, you know, worldwide fame, did he see that as kind of the blessing, or was it more of a curse that he was known for this so early in his career?
So I think it was both. Really, it was both. I think it was a blessing for him to be so popular, because he reached really a lot of people all over the world with his art, and he always crossed the borders of different genres. He made comic books. He made artwork for bands. He made books. He made the design for movies and so on. So it was a blessing for him. But it was a pity for him that he never gets the acknowledgement of the art establishment. And that I know he suffered from that.
So obviously he didn't get to see the finished film. What was it like when you did the premiere for the film?
Oh, it was great. It was overwhelming, really. There were a lot of emotions, deep emotions. And of course I was happy because I did it. I could realize this film. I showed it. And I was very, very sad because Hans-Rudi Giger was not there. He died a few months before. So everybody of us, we were very sad too. So it was really very ambivalent. It was quite special.
Do you maintain your contact with the family?
Yes, a lot. Yeah, I see Carmen Giger a lot. I visit her a lot of times. I keep her informed what is going on with the film. There are a lot of festivals now. We had the Asian premiere last week. I go to Linz, Austria, where we did the shooting for the last time. He had his an exhibition there. So I had a shooting with H.R. Giger there. So we make a premiere there. So there's a lot of things going on, and I keep her informed, of course.
That's wonderful. I can't imagine what they're going to do with the houses, with all of the materials that he has, all those books, for goodness sakes, those books were overwhelming.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think they leave it there as it is. And Carmen, she is still living there. So the business as usual is going on. Tom is working there. So it is not like a museum. Tom is working. Carmen is living there. But they don't touch a lot of things, I would say. So I think they really like to keep it like it is.
Right. Well, it's got to preserve their memories quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I know you're really busy with the documentary. Have you thought about what your next project is at all, or are you just going to kind of let that come?
Well, yeah, I have a lot of things in mind, but nothing to tell yet.
Is there a website for the film?
Yeah, yeah. I can send you the address if you want.
Okay.
We are also on Facebook or on Twitter, so I can send you all the information.
Wonderful. Well, I'll be sure to link to those through our website and spread the word as much as I can.
Great, great. I appreciate that a lot.
See, that wasn't too hard, right? You should have no fears of doing English interviews. You were perfect.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
So thanks to Belinda Sallin for taking the time to talk to us. It was pretty funny, Rob. She was very nervous about her English, and I think she speaks English better than I do. So it was great talking to her, and hopefully we will talk to her again one of these days. I look forward to whatever her next project is. So any additional thoughts about H.R. Giger's world?
It's just a great focused piece on an artist. And if you're interested in that artist, I think it adds extra levels to your understanding. And that's really what I got from it, because I was like a lot of folks, it's like, yeah, I know the alien design. I know these album covers. I've seen some of his art books, but I didn't know how he started. I didn't know where it came from. And that's always interesting. It's always interesting to sort of see what the process is. Cause I'm like, that's my thing. Like, I'm a big process guy. Like, I'm really interested in, well, where do people get these ideas? How do they develop them? What is it maybe from their youth that helps push them in that direction instead of doing something else? I mean, the one thing that comes up in the film was his father owned a drugstore. He was a chemist and wanted him to go in to basically run the family business. And he was like, you know, he's like, I really don't want to do that. I want to be an artist and try and, to be an artist in that day was like, well, I guess you just want to starve, I guess, because that's not really a career, son. You know, so it's interesting to sort of see what it is and what the passions are and what the obsessions are within someone that allows them to create a body of work that I would say is as unified as his work is. Because much like I talked about before the interview, when you see Dali, you know it's Dali. When you see Giger, you know it's Giger. It's that vision is that strong, and that's what he does. And that's what's interesting is to sort of peel back the layers a little bit and see what's in there.
If you've ever want to see a grown, tattooed, very gruff-looking man cry, H.R. Giger's world is for you. The scene of the guy getting his book signed at Giger's museum and him just bursting out into tears afterwards, one of the most touching scenes that I've seen in a long time.
And it just shows that the value that people create when they create a vision, when they create an idea, it can be that powerful for people. You know, music, film, art in general, it's not to be taken lightly.
Definitely not. All right, H.R. Giger's World, go find out about it at darkstar-movie.com. According to the website, it will be in theaters May 15th, 2015. It's coming to VOD August 18th, 2015, and it is coming to DVD They still make DVDs, apparently, on September 1st, 2015. Definitely one to pick up and put in your library.
Hey, that's a good day, that September 1st. I'll tell you why.
Do tell.
Because you could go out to the store and you can buy two things to put into your library. One, this movie, and my book comes out September 1st. How do you like that?
Holy shit.
Pure coincidence.
Wow. Yeah. You and H.R. Giger all in one foul swoop.
I can die now. It's over.
Thank you. Into grips of rain. If you enjoy this show and want more people to know about it, head on over to iTunes, leave a comment, and rate it 5 stars. Make sure you like and share us on Facebook, and don't forget to follow us on Twitter. Just search for Christopher Media. Thank you in advance for supporting Christopher Media by clicking on the PayPal button and by clicking through to all the sponsors who support ChristopherMedia.net. Most importantly, we would like to take the time to extend an extra special thanks to you. Christopher Media could not exist without your support. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net, and thank you for listening. Christopher Media. Let's make some noise.